Okay. Thank you for the introduction, and of course, thank you very much for this invitation. This presentation is going to be a little bit in the intersection of the topics discussed in the presentation yesterday and today. During my stay at Duke University, I had the opportunity to join an interdisciplinary research group that had two goals. One was to generate a synthetic version of a confidential data set, and the other one was to create a verification server. In this interdisciplinary research group, there were people from statistics, like Jerry Ryder and I. Jerry Ryder is my postdoctoral mentor. In computer science, Alwin and Jan were the experts in privacy, in finding this team. We have people from political science, which are the ones that know very well the data set that we wanted to synthesize, and people from the Office of Informatic Technology, which are the ones that they provide infrastructure to build all these systems. So today, I want just to share a little bit of what was my experience in this specific project. Okay. So the idea here was to create a synthetic version of a data set coming from the Office of Personnel Management. So in this is a data set that is a confidential data set, although now there are some variables that are already public. But this data set comprises information of roughly 3.5 million of US federal employees. We have information on 29 variables and 24 years, okay? As I said, the idea here was to create a synthetic version of this data set. And we did so through a statistical model, meaning we designed a statistical model that was fitted to this confidential data set, and then we used that statistical model to generate a synthetic or simulated version of this synthetic data set. The model doesn't satisfy differential privacy.
Maybe to relate it back to Frauke's talk, is this the kind of data? Is this a data set which you would have to analyze normally in a secure enclave, or like the kind of research center that
it would be, or not even that? I mean, in the U.S., this, I mean, very restricted access to this one so far.
Okay. Thank you.
Sorry.
No, thank you.
The Chinese hacked into it. This is the one, and it's now available.
Okay. Yeah. Well, but the kind he was asking about the kind.
Exactly.
Okay, so the design of a statistical model for this type of data set was not an easy task, not only because the number of variables, the number of years, and the number of employees is not small, but also because there are too many particular aspects related to this data set that we needed to account for during the statistical modeling. For example, the data set has missing data, or structural zeros, or it has errors, and one of the questions that we had to answer was, okay, do we want also the synthetic data with the same structure, meaning we want to have missing data in the synthetic data, we want to have structural zeros we have to respect the structural zeros in the synthetic data, we want to have errors in the synthetic data. So because if the idea is to mimic the confidential data set, that's something that we should incorporate in the synthetic data set. Also, for example, if this is like, in this data set we have federal agencies. So in the synthetic version of these federal agencies, we expect to have a single director. But if we just generate randomly from this statistical model, chances are that we don't have a director for that specific agency, or we end up with multiple directors. And so those are all these kind of things we had to take into account during the modeling process. In fact, it took us like a year and a half in order to have the first version of this synthetic data set, and almost 2 years in order to have what we consider the final version of this data set. Of course, the idea would be like to do this, or to design a statistical model with differential privacy, but our first step was to, let's try to do with a regular statistical model. So now assume that there is a user that has access to this synthetic data set, and that this user perform a statistical analysis on this data set, obtain this statistic T, and the idea is to use this statistic T to make inferences about a parameter of interest. Okay? Ideally, we would like that the results obtained with the confidential and the synthetic data set, they should match. That would be like the ideal. But we know that that's not going to happen 100% of the times. So if we have a data set with the complexity of the OPM data set, we know that that's not going to happen. We expect that these results, they should match most of the times, but not 100% of the times. The problem is the user of the synthetic data set will never know if the results they match or not, because the user doesn't have access to the confidential data set. For that reason, as a second goal in this project was to create what is called a verification server. So the idea here is the user submits a query to the system, and the system runs the same or equivalent statistical analysis on the confidential data set and reports an output that that can be used for the can be used to assess if this is the result with the synthetic and the confidential data set, they match. That's essentially the idea here. Because the verification server has access to the confidential data set, and there is a user that can submit queries to this verification server. So for that reason, we decided to design verification measures that satisfies differential privacy. More specifically, the kind of verification measures that we decided to design was essentially to define a differential private version of the statistics that the user is using for the statistical analysis. Okay? So today, I'm going to talk more, a little bit more about what we did in this specific part, how we designed this differentially private version of the statistic that we are using for the analysis. And I just want to show you also a pilot application of this verification server.
Mm-hmm. Are you agnostic to the method by which the synthetic data set was generated? That is, are we allowed to use information, or is it just like somebody hands you a synthetic data set and the verification server can, you know, just has to see if things match up? Or does the verification server know how the synthetic data was generated and uses that in its...
In fact, that's something that it's a comment that I'm going to make later, because there should be an agreement between the model that you are using to generate the synthetic data and the model that you are using to perform this statistical analysis. Yes. So, in this case, okay. So, as I said, I'm going to focus essentially in how we define this differentially private statistic. The way how we achieve differential privacy here was using a very simple technique, which was using subsample and aggregate, meaning we just split the data set into subset, let's say for the sake of this presentation, three subsets. Then we compute a statistic here. This statistic is T prime and is prime because it doesn't, sometimes could be the same T statistic that we are here, but sometimes we cannot use the same statistic. Then we have to aggregate these results, for example, using the average or using the sum of these statistics. And then once we are able to characterize the sensitivity of this statistic, which is usually the sensitivity of the T prime statistic divided by the number of subsets, we are able to just to use the Laplace mechanism to create or to define this differentially private T statistic. At this point, I just want to say that I am not an expert on privacy, but my contribution in this specific scenario was to try to understand what are the statistical consequences of using these data splitting strategies. In particular, for example, we wanted to answer this question: under which condition the statistic using the entire data set and the statistics that we derive using the subsample and aggregate, they are equivalent. Under which conditions the equivalent, let's say, in distribution, or we expect to have the same outputs or the same, or to make the same conclusions, or how we can use this statistic to make statements about this other statistic, okay? Also, and this was something that we heard a couple of times yesterday, also try to understand, we need to answer this question, how we can make a proper inference using this differentially private t statistic. Well, assuming that this statistic is coming from this data splitting strategy, maybe we have some truncation here, we have some error, we have to derive the proper, like for example, sampling distribution to make these inferences. So in addition to report, let's say, the differentially private t statistic, we want to report a summary that the user can use to make the inferences. For example, if this t statistic is associated with the with a hypothesis test, maybe we can also, or we should include the p-value in this as an output of this verification server. Okay.
We're confused by the figure now. So, at what point does DS actually, the verification server has access to the synthetic data or no?
The verification server, no. The user has access to the verification. To the
synthetic data.
To the synthetic data. We could use the synthetic data in the verification, but we are not.
You're not using it.
We are not. We are not using it.
So in some sense, do I even care that this entire bottom branch exists, or like?
It depends, because if you know the exact query that you want to submit, yes. But for example, in a data set like the OPM data set, you need to define a model. You need to be sure that the model makes sense, right? It's not like, oh, I'm going to, in the regression model, I just want to use these variables as a response variable and these variables as a predictors, and that's it. You have to do some model checking. Maybe you have to remove some variable. You have to redefine some part of the models. And that's something that you can achieve through the synthetic data set, right? Otherwise, it's going to be almost impossible to say, oh, I'm going to model this variable with this other predictor in this specific way, and I'm going to ask for this regression coefficient. But as I said, if you know exactly which coefficient you want to verify using this strategy, and you are pretty sure that the model is a reasonable choice for the confidential data set, you can do it. But that's, from the practical perspective, is a little bit more complicated to achieve. In this project, we were interested in developing DP verification measures for regression analysis. In this case, we assume that there is a variable that is the response variable, another variables that are other variables that are predictors, and probably some variable that I'm not going to consider in this regression model. Then I'm going to model the response variable as a linear combination of the predictors plus an error. And what we want to do specifically is to generate or to design verification measure for these regression coefficients. Something that I want to say now, and I thought that was your question before, is like there should be a coherence between the model that, or the way how you are, between the model that you are using to generate the synthetic data and the model that you are using to analyze the synthetic data. Technically, they should be, let's say, the same model. In other words, if you are using a normal model to generate the synthetic data, it's expected that you should use a normal model to analyze the synthetic data. Otherwise, you are in a sort of misspecification, and you have to be careful with what you are doing there. For example, if you generate the model with a Gaussian model, if you generate the synthetic data with a Gaussian model, and then you want to analyze set of these variables using a beta or gamma model. That's just a sort of misspecification that could be a problem. So you need to be sure that what you are doing in the with the synthetic data essentially matches with the model that you are using for the synthesis. In our case, for example, we use most of the time non-parametric techniques. So in that case, to generate the synthetic data. So in that case, it makes more sense to start thinking like specific parametric models to model part of the data. But still, we need to do some model checking to be sure that the model that we are using, for example, the regression model, is still a reasonable choice.
Excuse me.
What was Z? I'm saying that the confidential data set, well, you have information like the response variable, you can have the predictors, and other variables that you are not using. But when you generate this data, you are using a model, and then if you want to generate, if you want to model the response given the predictor, then you should respect this distribution, and essentially they should match. That's essentially the.
Are you doing full synthesis or partial synthesis? Okay, so you're assuming that even Z's are being synthesized.
Yeah, everything is synthesized. Yeah, yeah. At the beginning, I mean, when we started working on these 3-4 years ago, there were not, I'm not sure if there were some variables already public, but then there were now there are some variables that are public.
Okay, but I also just to understand, and maybe this relates in part to another question or not, you can correct me. So you comment on the coherence between the models, I understand, but that does mean that you do not account in any way down the road for the model, the synthesis model that you used, and basically the error that was introduced by using the particular synthesis model. Because you're arguing for the coherence, because in some cases, if you do account for the variability or randomness that would come from the synthesis process itself, that would address some of the coherence issue and allow you for a larger potential use of the model if you account for it. But I don't think anyone does this in statistics, at least I'm not aware of. So I just wanted to check that you're
yeah,
wrong, right?
No, in this case, you are not dealing,
okay.
You're not dealing with that.
Then I understand.
Yeah, but otherwise, other option would be like to release multiple synthetic data sets, and then you can do something.
That would be one way to know, right? Here you're only talking about a single.
We generate only a single one.
Thank you.
So I'm going to talk a little bit about the specific verification measures that we develop here, essentially these two. One that essentially can be used to check if the coefficient estimate on the confidential data set falls within a specific interval. I'm going to spend most of my time probably in this one. This is a very, let's say, pragmatic solution at that point. And I think that if I have time, then I'm going to talk a little bit about how we define a differentially private t statistic for regression, I mean, to test if the coefficient is equal to zero, for example. As I said, in this interdisciplinary group, we have these political scientists, and they were interested in this type of analysis. They were interested in analyzing differentials in pay by race. In other words, race-wage gap. And for them, the variable that they wanted to use was, for example, the logarithm of the employee's basic pay. And as a predictor, they have race, age, educational level, occupation, and agency. So this is just a little bit of notation. So let's assume, I mean, here beta hat n is the estimator of this regression coefficient. It could be beta 1 or any beta. We are going to denote like beta hat cn and beta hat et sn, like the estimate, like the specific values that we obtain using the confidential and synthetic data set and using the corresponding, I mean, this estimator. In the analysis that they performed on the synthetic data set, they found that most of these regression coefficients, they were below this value, below this 1% that has a meaning for what they were analyzing. So they want to verify if the coefficient on the synthetic data set also is below this minus 1%. So after some discussion with them, what we decided to do, or what we proposed, was verifying how likely is to get an coefficient estimate that is below that that threshold. In other words, what we want to do here is to essentially to compute the probability that we can generate a estimate that is below that threshold. In other words, this is the probability that we would like to use essentially as a verification measure. And we want to estimate that using the confidential data set. Okay? So in general, the idea here is like try to verify this event, meaning the coefficient falls within a specific interval. We want to know how likely is that event, which is equivalent to essentially check if this indicator function is equal to 1, using this probability, the probability that the estimator is between this pre-specified regression coefficient. So again, as I already said, we use a subsample and aggregate here. We compute this W variables. Essentially, we are seeing if the corresponding estimate falls within those intervals, and then we aggregate them with the sum, meaning we are saying how many of these coefficients they fall within this pre-specified interval, and maybe we can release this S-bar differentially private statistic, which is essentially an approximation of the fraction of these coefficients that fall within that specific interval. Okay? But as I said at the beginning, our idea here was to try to understand what is the relationship between this, let's say, very simple statistic and the probability that we would like to use as a verification measure. So under some regularity conditions, we can assume that these coefficients are coming from the same population. And under that assumption, we have that this statistic S is just a binomial distribution where the number of trials is the number of subsets of the size of the partition, and the probability of success here is this probability. Okay, is the probability that you get that the estimator is between this, is in this interval. But notice here that this estimator is now computed with a sample size that is smaller than the sample size of the entire data set, because in the subset we are using, the sample size is smaller. So in this case, if we take like the statistic S divided by M, this is essentially an estimator of this probability. But that's not the probability that we were looking for. The probability that we wanted to use as a verification measure was this one. So the next step was, okay, how we can use this probability to make statements about this probability that is the one that we really care about. Well, again, under some regularity conditions, we can assume that these two statistics, they have the same distribution, let's say normal distribution. If the estimators are unbiased, so they have the same mean, so the only difference there is the variance. And I already know that the variance of the one associated with the subsets is essentially M times the variance of the entire, of the statistic using the entire data set. And if we use this specific relationship, then we can understand how we can use the probability that we compute with less data points. And this is, for example, one of the strategies that we can use here. So if A and B are finite, meaning this is a finite interval, and the probability using less data points is greater than 0.5, then that probability becomes a lower bound for the probability that we are really that we really care about. Okay, so if this probability is large, then we essentially are saying that this probability is also large. But we cannot say when the interval is this type, is of this type in general, that if this probability is small, then this probability is also small. No, we can also, it's a lower bound. It's a little bit different when the interval is of this form, like minus infinity to b, or from b to infinity. And this would be the relationship between these two probabilities. This is the probability using the n data points, and in here is using n over 3 data points, or m over 50 data points. And what we can observe here is that when this probability is small, then the probability that we really care about is also small. And also, if this probability is large, then that probability is also large. So the point here is like there is a way that we can use this probability to make essentially statements about the probability that we would like to use as a verification measure. Now that we know that, well, we are using the fact that S is a binomial distribution. We want to make inferences about this probability, but we have access to a noisy version of this statistic, and using a Bayesian model, and we discussed like this type of strategies a little bit yesterday, we can account for the fact that we are adding noise, because I can characterize this distribution very easily. This is like we know that the distribution of the noisy statistic given S is a Laplace, will mean S, and this scale. And then I know the rest of the model, and I can just use MCMC to get the posterior distribution of this probability. And then I can release, we can release this probability and use that to, let's say, essentially as a verification measure here. So this would complete the final product that we would like to provide for this specific type of verification. Here, as I said at the at the beginning, the experts, I mean the political scientists, they want to verify if the regression coefficient is less than 1%. And the idea was to use this probability. So what we are going to use at the end, instead of using the entire posterior distribution, we are going to use the mode of the posterior distribution as a verification measure here. So in this case, let's look at this part of the female's regression. In this case, these are the estimates using the synthetic data set. These are the estimates using the confidential data set. And these one are the modes of the corresponding posterior distribution. So the idea here is like, ideally we would like that these two, they should match somehow. Like for example, given this threshold, we would like that both they should be below, like in this case, both are below this 1%. And in that case, we want this the verification measure be near 1, which is what is happening here. The other case is when they are above the threshold, which is like in this case. So in that case, we want the mode of this posterior distribution being small, which is what is happening. In this case, for example, the confidential coefficient is right, essentially the same as the threshold. And in that case, we expect that that mode should be near 0.5. Well, and these results, they are not always matched, but the verification measure is telling us what is where the coefficient is.
Mm-hmm. I'm just trying to, since it's far out of my expertise, trying to go into a story. So I'm a political scientist, and I'm doing some study, and I can't really figure out how to make it this table, but suppose I discover that agency, I mean, I get a regression coefficient for agency, the type of agency like doesn't, is very tiny. So then I would say, but I want to conclude that I can ignore it for the purposes of my regression model, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so that's what the verification server would say, like, oh, it's okay. You should, you can't, you're seeking safety.
In this case, they can say, okay, you know what, if the gap, the race-wage gap, essentially represented by this coefficient is less than 1%, this is something that we should put a lot of attention. It's really important for us.
Okay.
But it's more like in terms of the magnitude, more than the significance.
Okay.
That's essentially, that was the idea behind this, like having this tool. Okay? Okay. But it turns out that when we use these data splitting strategies, sometimes we cannot compute the estimate, right? Because when we split the data, and if there is a categorical variable in the model, and that categorical variable has few data points, then chances are that nobody in this subset has that specific category, that specific race in this case. And in that case, we are going to get an A. Or even worse, imagine that that specific level is used as a reference level. So that means that all the rest of the coefficients are going to be an NA. Or maybe the software has a default and then use a different reference. You don't know that, and then you are combining things that you shouldn't combine. Okay? So, but this was something that definitely could happen, and in particular with races that they have a low frequency. And so in this case, what we decided to do was to redefine these Ws so that we know if the coefficient was an NA. And given that it was not an NA, then we are going to be able to know if it fall within the interval or outside the interval. And in this case, well, the sum of this W would be a multinomial distribution, and then we can use essentially the same trick, right? And then we can use this probability, the probability that we can get an NA, and if that probability is large, then probably we shouldn't say anything about this coefficient if we are getting too many NAs, okay? And in this case, again, it's I can model this with this Bayesian model. We need a Dirichlet distribution for this vector of probabilities. And then we can, as I said, we can release the posterior distribution here as a verification measure in this verification server. Okay, now let me show you just a little bit like a pilot application that we have for this verification server and for this specific verification measure. So in this verification server, what we are going to have is like these tabs. The first one is selection, where you specify the model. The second one is, in this case, we also we also have a work where we can provide a differentially private version of the residual plots that can be used to assess if the model is a good choice. So that should be the first step. And then we can use this specific tab to make the verification using this specific verification measure. So in this case, the user will be able to select the dependent variable, add independent variables. In here, the user can also specify the reference level, can use interactions, can subset the data, and once the model is is fully specified, then the user can click here, submit the model, and if you scroll down, and here, for example, we can have the privacy budget, how much are you allowed to use in the system. So if you click this button, submit query, and then you scroll down, you will get this table. These are the coefficients, but this is the coefficients on the synthetic data. And we think that this is like this kind of outputs are really important to display in the system, because if you have the synthetic data in your computer, we have to be sure that the model that you want to use as a verification is the exact model that you are specifying here. Maybe you are using a different software, maybe you forgot to add a variable, or maybe the reference level is different. So this is a kind of sanity check that these estimates should match with the ones that you have in your computer with the synthetic data. If they match, then you know that essentially is the same model. Then the next step would be to click here, go to the coefficient verification. And in that case, the user will be able to select the epsilon that wants to use. In this case, it's an epsilon per regression coefficient. It can select the size of the partition, the coefficient that it wants to verify, and then has to specify the interval for the regression coefficients. In this case, they didn't allow to add the minus infinity. So for that reason, this is like the version of the minus 250 to this one is representing the interval minus 250 and minus infinity. Okay, and here the user will have two different options: start verification on the synthetic data, or do the verification on the original data. If you click here, you are not going to pay, and you don't have to pay epsilon because you are running the same verification. But because you know what is happening with the with the synthetic data, then you can use this verification to see if what you are going to get after is going to match with what you have with the synthetic data. So in this case, if the user clicks this button, then it's going to run the verification the verification measure in the synthetic data. It's going to get these outputs. This one is associated with the probability of getting an NA. This is associated with the probability of getting that the interval falls in within that interval, and these are the modes of these posterior probabilities. But also, the user can get the posterior probability for the NAs or for the probability that the coefficient is in a given interval. The idea here is like this. Modes, they should reflect what you have when you use the synthetic data. And the idea here is like the user can use the synthetic data to somehow specify or redefine like the parameters of the differentially private method. So can probably think that they should add more epsilon, or maybe change the number of partitions, or redefine the confidence interval. And once the user is kind of sure about that, then can click this button. It's gonna get this result. So you are about to submit a query here. You are going to spend 3 epsilon here that you want to proceed. And if so, then you are gonna get now these outputs. Okay, this is not we are not using the real data set here. This is a simulated data set that, for example, in here, you get that the fraction of NAs is too large, so you shouldn't trust this. That would be more or less the idea of use this. And then we are going to the privacy budget is going to get updated. So this is just a very simple application, but that was the way how we envisioned this idea of the verification server. So we also have verification measures for page gap trends over time that we use essentially the similar idea, and for more details they are in this paper. I don't have time to talk about how we do the T statistics, but that was definitely another option that we that we another verification measure that we designed, and we also were able to find conditions under this average of truncated T rescale statistics. They provide a reasonable approximation of the statistic using the entire data set. Okay? So some final comments. So the idea in this project was to propose and apply these differentially private methods for regression coefficients. Some of these methods, well, they are also valid without the context of verification servers. We know that if the sample size is small, it's a problem for the accuracy of the method when we split a lot, or if we use a large number of subsets. The good point of the data splitting strategies are they are scalable, so you can parallelize them really easily. Well, we have some ongoing work to design models or to design methods that allow us to test that multiple regression coefficients can be equal zero. Okay? So this is pretty much. Thank you.
We can have a couple minutes of questions. So I have a question about the verification framework. So it seems like at the high level, what you're doing is you submit some coefficients for your linear model, and the verification server seems to return like whether it is like close enough to the coefficient you would have gotten had you trained it on the true data.
Yeah.
So it seems like it's like a closeness kind of query, like, you know, like it's like checking whether the error is above some threshold or not, right? So
when you say the error is like the difference between
the
synthetic and the confidential.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So are you taking advantage of the fact that this is, you know, answering this form of threshold inquiries for on a sequence actually can be cheaper than, you know, naively composing the individual epsilon over time?
The sparse vector technique.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, I don't think so.
So there might be a saving happening there. Like if all you care about is a sequence of above or below threshold queries, oftentimes you don't actually need to pay for individual epsilon. But, you know, you need to check details work.
I'm almost sure that there was some type of discussion like that with Ashwin.
Okay.
But I don't know exactly about this.
They need the numbers actually, as opposed to just a threshold.
Yeah, the question is whether you actually need like how far it is, like, you know, you how far the two set of coefficients are, in order for you to use that number to adjust your model. If you don't need that, then I think the kind of saving I'm talking about should be possible.
Okay.
More questions. All right, let's thank the speaker again.
Thank you.